Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnana Anjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Hare Krishna. So I'm sharing the screen now. We'll be continuing with chapter 16, 17, 18. So it's auspicious that on the last day of Kartik, we are having a last session on the Bhagavad-gita. And we'll discuss the last three chapters, and we'll also have some time for question answers, Krishna willing. If at any time I'm not audible, please let me know and I will see what adjustment needs to be done. You can send me a message. Just a minute. I'm going to start off here. So we go over what we've discussed till now. We completed 15 chapters of the Bhagavad-gita, and in the last six chapters, Krishna is focusing on moving toward bhakti through jnana. So Arjuna's driving question is, what should I do? What is dharma? And Krishna answers that at multiple levels. And in the last few chapters, chapter actually from 10th chapter onwards, it is more like a question answer session in which some answers are longer, some answers are shorter, and Krishna is elaborating on diverse spiritual themes which tie into the overall message of God-centeredness that he has given. So the 14th chapter was the three modes of material nature. The 15th talked about how this material world develops based on the modes, and it introduced the metaphor of the upside down tree. The 16th chapter continues that metaphor and describes what exists at the bottom and the top of the tree, what exists at the two extremes of the tree, and that is the divine and the demoniac natures. Daiva Asura Sampad Vibhaga Yoga, the Sanskrit name for this chapter. Daiva is the divine, Asura is demonic. And this chapter has 24 verses, and we'll discuss. Let's look at the overview of the verses. So Krishna initially gives a list of divine qualities in verses 1 to 3. And after that, he says, I have explained these in detail. Now, what do we mean by divine and demoniac qualities? Krishna says, first of all, that we are born with these qualities. So, for example, 16.4 states that Dambho darpo bhimanascha krodha parushyamevacha agyanam cha abhijatasya partha sampadamasurim. So, abhijatasya, one is born with all these qualities. So now, if somebody is born, what does that mean? Does it mean that that's what they are fated to have throughout their life? Basically, what Krishna is saying is that the qualities we have at birth come from our previous lives. So the whole chapter's theme is that we are determined by our past, but we are not entirely determined by our past. So those people who have done demoniac activities in their past, they will be born now with demoniac qualities. And those who have done godly activities, they will be born with godly qualities. So divine and demoniac. Now, sometimes the word demoniac might sound a little jarring. So as alternative, softer alternative, the words godly and ungodly are also used. Now, we wouldn't want to call somebody specifically as demoniac. So in this chapter, Krishna focuses primarily on the demoniac qualities, because the divine, the godly qualities, he has described many times in the past. He has described the characteristics of the self-controlled in the second chapter. He has described the qualities of those devoted to him in the 12th chapter. He has described from 12:13 to 20, he has described. From 255 to 272, he has described. And then from 13:8 to 12, he has described the characteristics of those who are in knowledge. In 10 chapter also, 6, 7, 3, 4, 5, 6, he has described. So many places, the qualities of the godly have been described. So Krishna gives those qualities as a quick list, but he focuses most of the chapter on the demoniac qualities. And broadly, we could say qualities are internal, activities are external. Now, qualities impel us to certain activities, and our activities reinforce certain qualities. So there is a natural connection between the two. Initially, when Krishna talks about the demoniac qualities, his stress is primarily on their rejection of anything spiritual, any ultimate meaning to life. In today's world, there is a lot of concern about fanaticism, wherein somebody is too irrationally, too dogmatically, too zealously attached to a particular ideology or a particular belief system, particular set of practices. We call it fanaticism. And we are concerned about that. And yes, there is a natural need to be concerned about that. But what is not thought about so much is that having no worldview at all, that is also very disempowering. That is actually, that means we all need to make sense of the world around us. And some people hold their ideology in such a way that, say, if this is the ideology, they hold it right in front of their eyes. So they can't see anything except through the filter of that ideology. And that kind of fanaticism, now, of course, that is not healthy. And there is a danger of people becoming irrational or violent or sectarian by that. But the other danger is also nihilism. Nihilism is where fanatical people, they try to make sense of life through one worldview only. And they try to reduce all of reality to their worldview. So if their ideology declares, say, for example, communism declares that the wealthy are all exploitative and the poor are all victims. And anybody who is wealthy, anyone who is powerful, anyone who is prosperous, they must have exploited others, and that's how they became like this. Now, it could be, but it could also be that they are competent. And everybody who is poor and deprived, it's not necessary that they are so because they have been exploited. Sometimes they themselves might have made terrible choices. They have made a mess of their lives. So if somebody is ideologically blinded, the idea is anybody who's wealthy, grab their wealth and take it away from them because they must be exploiters. No, not everyone who's wealthy is exploiter. Now, of course, some people can be, but the point is that when we adopt an ideology, it is said that if someone has a hammer, then everything looks like a nail for them. Everything looks like a nail. That means we try to fit everything into that ideology. So the Bhagavad-gita offers a very nuanced philosophy where it describes that there are three modes and three modes can intermingle and different people can manifest different qualities at different times. So what the Bhagavad-gita offers us is not exactly an ideology. It offers us a tool by which it is a resourceful and multifaceted tool by which we can observe reality. And the tool is complex, reality is complex, and we need to carefully navigate so that we make sense of life. But the point here I'm making is one demoniac quality Krishna says is nihilism. Nihilism is where people reject all meanings in life. They say life has no meaning. And we are simply meaning manufacturing machines who manufacture meaning even when no meaning is there. But actually, this is asatyam apratishtham te jagadahuranishwaram aparaspara sambhutam kimanyat kamahetukam. So this idea that actually we simply create meaning ourselves and there is no inherent meaning is a very destructive ideology, because its result is ultimately people lose all sense of meaning, and once they lose all meaning, they may do anything and everything just for their own immediate pleasures. If we don't have anything to fight for, we will fight for anything. It's not that we'll stop fighting. So some people may fight irrationally, that is fanaticism. But nihilism is the other opposite, where nothing is worth fighting for. But when nothing is worth fighting for, that doesn't mean people become passive. People have rajas in them, people have tamas in them, the modes of passion and ignorance. And they will pick up some trivial cause and start fighting for those. So Krishna talks about nihilism also as a demoniac worldview. And Krishna talks about atheism at a foundational level. If we go to the atheistic ideology, it can be very profoundly nihilistic. And Friedrich Nietzsche was a prominent German philosopher. He said that God is dead and we have killed him. He said that this horrendous act that we have done, it is because of this, the whole sky is crumbling, the earth is collapsing, and the oceans are drying, and now existence can no longer be sustained. So he recognized that if there is no transcendence to human life, then there'll be no structure within which to have meaning, and the result would be disaster. So he predicted that there will be, if we don't find some other meaning, there'll be that totalitarianism, government absolutism, which is what happened, say, for example, when in the communist agenda, or there can be just obsessive individualism, where people just try to do their own thing and nobody cares for anything else. So we will create a false god if we reject the ultimate god. Now, when Krishna talks about the activities of the demoniac, so 1 to 9 is qualities, and one quality I focused on is nihilism, a rejecting of any ultimate meaning in life. And then what are the activities? So if there is no ultimate meaning, then we seek immediate meaning in pleasure. Whatever gives us pleasure, that's what we will do. And such people, Krishna describes in that they can become very cold-blooded. That in their pursuit of wealth and power, they can eliminate anyone else. Asau maya hata shatrur. Hanishye cha paranapi ishvaro aham aham bhogi. Siddho aham balwan sukhi. In 1614, he says that asau maya hata shatru. This enemy I have killed, and that enemy I will now kill. And in that way, this has just become deadly destructive. That's the activities of the demoniac. And then, after that, they become destructive towards others, anyone who is a potential opponent. And then such people may even do religion. So, but they will do religion for show. Yajante nama yajnaiste dambhena vidhi purvakam. So Krishna says in 16:17 that they will do yajna for nama, not yajna of nama. They won't chant the names of God. They will use God's name to just get a better name for themselves. That some people, especially if they live in a pious society, then if they appear religious, then they get respect through that. So for them, religion is like a social cosmetic. It is not a spiritual transformer. It is a social cosmetic for them. So we can't just look at if somebody is just visiting a temple or doing some sacrifice or giving some charity, you might say this is good. Yes, it is good. But it is not necessarily done with a good intention. And one's intention can sometimes supersede one's action. And then Krishna talks about, from 19 to 22, what are the consequences of living like this? He says that such people will go to hellish conditions. Now, the word hell in today's world is at one level, it is used, but the idea of a hell is not a very popular idea. And one reason for that comes from the Abrahamic religions, where hell is considered to be a place of eternal torment. And if one doesn't surrender to God in this one lifetime, surrender to accepting, say, in Christianity, is that if you don't accept Jesus as a savior, then we'll go to hell forever. But what the Bhagavad-gita says is that hell is not like a place for eternal torment. It is also a classroom. The whole universe is a university, and hell is also a classroom, but it is a especially tough classroom. It's like some in some rooms, things are comfortable. In some rooms, especially where there are very undisciplined students, they might be put in harsher conditions. So the key thing to understand is that hell is temporary. Hell is not eternal. And those who are sent to hell, they are sent there that so that in the school of hard knocks, they learn to reform their mentality. And what is the mentality that is to be reformed? That Krishna says is three things primarily, three drives. Trividham narkasyedam dwaram nashanam atmanah kamah krodhastha lobas tasmadetatrayam tejet. So kama, krodha and lobha, lust, anger and greed. So LAG, these cause us to lag in spiritual life. If they are in a mild quantity, if they're in a severe quantity, they drag us opposite to spiritual life. So to the extent these forces are present, Krishna says these are the doors to hell. The more we indulge in them, the more we not only go to a hellish destination in the next life, but we create a hellish disposition even in this life for ourselves. And then comes the significant part. In many ways, what Krishna describes in the 16th chapter is scarily similar to what we see in much of the world, not only today, but in much of history. How there are conquerors who are out to, are ready to kill thousands and thousands of people just so that they can get more territory, more power, more wealth or whatever. So Krishna says that if we are born with a particular nature, does that mean we are doomed to live accordingly? He says no. The last verses says that tasmat shastram pramanam te karya karya vyavasthitam gyatva shastra vidhanoktam karma kartum iharasi. Therefore, he says, follow shastra, and shastra will provide the pathway to become elevated. So now we may say, if somebody is demoniac, how can they follow shastra? So here we need to understand that shastra is not necessarily uniform. It is multiform. You can even say shastra is omniform. Uniform is just one set of rules and regulations for everyone. Multiform is there are many. Omniform is there are almost unlimited. So the idea is that the rules and regulations that the godly can follow will be different, will be often maybe higher, stricter. And the rules and regulations that the ungodly, the demoniac can follow, they may be lesser. So for example, some people are just attached to eating meat. And they can't give it up. So then there are rules for them for how they can regulate the UEDT. So that's what the scripture, it gives us multiple levels of adherence, levels to connect ourselves with, to settle ourselves on. And even the demoniac, if they regulate themselves within their demoniac dispositions, then they will not become worse, but they will become elevated. So the idea is that nobody is irredeemable. Even the demoniac are redeemable, and scripture has a program for everyone. But one should at least recognize that we need to raise our consciousness. We need to become purer. Unfortunately, those who are in a demoniac disposition, they think that living in the demoniac way is wonderful and there is no need to change. In fact, they often look down at those who are godly, and they think that you are just, you don't even know how to enjoy life. We are enjoying life and you are being fools, depriving yourself of life's pleasures. So when they think like this, then there is very little chance for elevating them. So scripture is like a hospital where everybody, no matter how seriously infected they may be, they can be cured. So the people in those who are in godly nature, they are more or less infected by the mode of goodness, which is quite good. It's a mild infection, you could say. Mode of passion is a serious infection, and mode of ignorance is like a lethal infection. But everybody can be cured, provided they stay in the hospital, and the hospital is Shastra. And as everybody, wherever they are, can be elevated. And here we'll go to 16:14 in this chapter, that Krishna says, I quoted this verse earlier, that those who are craving for wealth, they say, okay, by this scheme I have got this much wealth. Now, if I want to earn that wealth, that person is the obstacle for me. So let me eliminate that person, then I'll get more wealth. So that Krishna talks about how artha, when it is divorced from dharma, artha is prosperity, wealth. Dharma is the scriptural code of conduct. You could say morality and spirituality. It's ethics, basically. So we could translate this into English as ambition divorced from ethics leads to greed. We all want to grow in life. And we all want to, say, become more socially influential, more financially prosperous, more more popular or whatever. So prosperity is something which is natural human desire. And it's not, prosperity is not wrong, but even for seeking wealth, for fulfilling our ambitions, if we violate ethical limits in the pursuit of ambition, then that is when that ambition becomes greed and it causes destruction for ourselves and others. So artha is wealth. Anartha is, at one level, it means no wealth. But artha also has mean. Artha also means purpose or meaning. Now, what is the shabda artha? What is the meaning of this word? So artha, when we have some purposes which are short term, which don't bring any long term meaning to their lives, then they lead to anartha. Anartha means we develop certain conceptions that are ultimately meaningless. So lust, anger, greed, they're very deep rooted conceptions within us. But they strip our life of meaning. Those who pursue lust or greed, at the end of their lives, what do they have? They have nothing except a pile of bad karma, which they will have to suffer in their next lives. So this is artha divorced from dharma leads to anartha. So this is chapter 16. Any questions based on chapter 16 till now? Okay, so we'll move on to chapter 17 now. I'll rush through chapter 17 because chapter 18 is quite long and it's going to take a good amount of time for us. So let's look at chapter 17 now. So now Krishna has talked about two levels at the end of chapter 16. That is, those who are godly and those who are ungodly. And Krishna talks about how the godly have faith and then they follow a scriptural guideline in some way. So the ungodly, they reject scripture and then they go downward. So even for the ungodly, if they follow scripture, they can be elevated. So broadly speaking, we could say that the godly, the ungodly, and if you're going to define it not just by the qualities that somebody has, but also by whether they're going to adhere to scripture or not. So then Krishna says, what about somebody who is in between? They are following something. They're following some system of regulation, but not according to scripture. That what is their level? Yashastra vidhim utrujya vartate shraddhayanvita tesham nishthaduka krishna sattvamaho rajastamaha. That those who reject scripture and follow something, what is their level? And this could apply, say today there are so many different religious groups, spiritual notions, so-called lifestyles for higher consciousness. So much goes on in the name today of religion and spirituality. And how would we contextualize that within a scriptural worldview? The scripture may not, this organization, that group, these things, the scripture may not talk exactly about those groups. So how do we classify them? Where do we place them? So Krishna gives a framework. He says that look at how they are living. Look at the modes in which they are functioning. And he says that our faith makes us, and we make our faith, and then our faith makes us. That means by our choices, we develop a particular kind of conception, we develop a particular kind of faith. And then that, based on that faith, we start acting in particular ways. So here, Krishna says that when people practice austerity, even austerity can be done in a demoniac way. It's very sick. Like I talked earlier, charity can be given in a demoniac way, but somebody can do fasting. But if they're doing fasting so that, like demons would do fasting so that they can gain great power and they can destroy the whole world. That is demoniac austerity. So Krishna gives this as an extreme example of how faith in itself is not necessarily a good thing. We have to see what kind of faith it is. If somebody is doing enormous austerity, they have faith that if I do this austerity, I will get the result. So sometimes there was a demon, Rukasur, who wanted to do austerity so that whoever he would touch, that person would fall dead. That person's head would be would split apart and they would die. So now they're trying to gain power, but gaining power for a destructive purpose. So they have faith that the process of austerity will give me power. But that is not a healthy kind of faith. And Krishna basically talks about how do we recognize the mood of a person? That is through the kind of activities that they do. So in the 17th chapter, Krishna focuses primarily on the food. So the kind of food people eat, that is a fair indicator of their consciousness. And that is a fair indicator of the kind of faith that they have. Similarly, the sacrifice. Now these three words, sacrifice, austerity and charity, can have specific meanings. They can also have universal meanings. These are in Sanskrit called as yajna, dana, tapa. So these, if you study the dharmic literature, Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam or other literature, we find Mahabharata, Ramayana, these three words, yajna, dana, tapa, come quite frequently. And the idea over here is that actually these are ways in which we can harmonize ourselves with the bigger whole of which we are parts. We live in a social circle, we live in a physical, if we consider we are souls here, we are enclosed in a physical shell, physical circle, that is our body and mind. Then out beyond that we are social circle, and beyond that there is an environmental circle. These three activities are meant to harmonize us with the circles in which we are living. So austerity is meant to harmonize, help us live in harmony with our body. Modern science is also, for example, discovering the value of fasting. Therapeutic fasting is catching up. Because the idea is that if we constantly make our body work by putting food in it, occasionally if we give the body a break, then it can use that break to divert its energy from digesting and processing all the food to remove disposing of the waste from the body. So the idea is that austerity helps us to live in harmony with our body. And charity helps us to live in harmony with our social circle. From society, we take many things and we're meant to give many things. Give things in charity. So there one is a business reciprocation, but the another is more of a generous reciprocation. And then sacrifice, yajna, is what brings us in harmony with the broader universe, broader cosmos. So sacrifice in some ways today is manifesting as environmental consciousness. But even that environmental consciousness is, we have to see what conceptions people have and how they are doing it. But the idea is these three things can be understood specifically within the Vedic tradition or generically as universal activities that people do. So again, the point here is that through the kind of activities that people are doing, we can understand the kind of mood that they are in. So if somebody says that, okay, you know, I follow so-and-so teacher, I belong to XYZ group, then how do we know what is their level? What are they doing? How can we understand where they are? So we can inquire about their theology, we can inquire about their worldview. But Krishna doesn't focus so much on the theology over here. See, on the spiritual path, there is what is called as doxy and praxy. Like we have orthodoxy and orthopraxy. Doxy refers to doctrine and praxy refers to practices. So we often are concerned about what people's philosophical worldview is. If somebody goes to say some impersonalistic kind of, somebody's following a teacher who's impersonalist, then we say, oh, this person is an impersonalist, this person is a Mayavadi. And we often treat them almost like untouchables. Right? They're like very fallen or dangerous kind of people. But it's not that, we can't be that naive. Yes, people's philosophy has to be considered, but often how they live is more important than what they believe. And Krishna here, when he says we have to discern where people are, at what level people are when they're practicing a particular view, he doesn't go too much into what philosophy they're believing, but he says not so much on the doxy, but on the praxy. So how, what kind of food, sacrifice, charity, austerity, all these are about the praxy. Praxy is how do they live? And then, so that is from 7 to 22, that is the heart of the chapter. And 23 to 28 focuses on the principle that ultimately all sacrifices are meant for transcendence. They're meant to raise our consciousness to the transcendental level. And that is done by chanting Om Tat Sat. It is not simply chanting, but inculcating that consciousness. Om is ultimate reality. Om is a well-known mantra. So Om is a invocation of the divine. Tat is that reality which is other than me. So other than me, not mean that means separate, but I am here, that is there. So Tat Om Tat Sat. So I am coming out of myself and offering myself to some reality bigger than myself. Sat means eternal, real. So Om Tat Sat. I invoke that reality. I invoke that which is the ultimate reality, that which is real. Om is invoke. Tat is that, Sat is real. I invoke that which is real. That means all the activities I do, I offer them to the ultimate reality. So this is, of course, as I said, Krishna is leading from the process of intellectual analysis to the process of bhakti. So in bhakti also, the same mood, what is talked about in Om Tat Sat, that is also talked about in bhakti, by the mood of offering to the Lord. In the personal understanding, with an understanding of his personal conception and of the devotional disposition. Here it is more abstract. There is some ultimate reality and I'm offering. Whatever I'm doing, it's an offering to that ultimate reality. And Krishna says, ultimately, if somebody has an understanding of the ultimate and is pursuing that ultimate, then they are on an auspicious path. Otherwise, their path is inauspicious. So coming back to this point, which I mentioned earlier, that we are shaped not just by our ideological faith, but also by our functional faith. It's like doxy and praxy. That what ideological faith means, people say, oh, I believe in God. I believe in this teacher. I believe in this. I believe in that. Okay, what you believe in is fine, but how you live is more important. That's why sometimes this question comes up, can atheists be good people? Sometimes some atheists may be more gentle, polite, even more charitable than the theists. So can atheists be good people? Yes, definitely they can be. But we need to understand that atheism itself doesn't make people good. It is people who are good, they are because of maybe their past karma, their past nature that they have acquired, their cultural upbringing or whatever. And maybe they had some negative impressions about religion because of which they became atheistic. But so the point I'm making here is the ideological faith is like what you believe, and functional faith is how we live. So we could have some people who may be living very well, but their ideological faith is null and void. So it's like somebody who's driving a car. Some people might be a very expert car driver, but they have no map and no destination. They may drive very smoothly, but they won't get anywhere. Somebody may be driving very messily. They make a lot of noise. Their driving is jerky. They drain out their vehicle. They function in a way that harms other vehicles also, at least endangers them. But they know where they are going. They have a map and they are going toward their destination. So who is better? It depends on context. From the ultimate perspective, those who have a map and are going toward their destination, they are better. But presently, if you want to say who is better while driving, well, one person, those who are poor drivers, they will be making a mess. But those who are good drivers will not be making a mess. So basically, ideological faith refers to whether we have a worldview with which we are pursuing some destination. But functional faith refers to how we are living. And best is whether that we have clear destination. Somebody has a clear destination to which they want to go, and they also have a map by which they can go. They also have the good driving skills by which they can get to the destination. That's why when Srila Prabhupada was asked, how do we know your followers? He said that they are perfect gentlemen and ladies. He didn't say so much that, they wake up in the morning, they chant this many rounds, they follow they abstain from all these activities. All that is true. But the world doesn't care so much for that. What the world cares for is how we behave. So how we live. So if we are courteous and polite in our behavior, if we're gentlemanly, we are dignified, then people are attracted by that. And that's what we seek to emulate in our lives. So we have a strong ideological foundation, but we also have a healthy way of functioning in our lives. This is chapter 17. Any comments or questions about this? Okay, so let's go on to chapter 18 now. As I mentioned, this is a long chapter. In fact, this is the longest chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. There's 78 verses in it. And it's going to take a long time to cover this. We'll try to cover as much as we can. But most of it, Krishna has already covered in the past, but he's going in greater analytical detail and depth here. So the 18th chapter also begins with a question by Arjuna that what is it that we are meant to? That which is better? Is renunciation better or is tyaga and sannyasa? Because he uses two words. Is accepting the renounced order better or is renouncing the fruits of work better? So Krishna says both are good, but he says focus is more on the disposition rather than the position. Whether one is in renounced order or not, why if one has a renounced disposition, that is auspicious, Krishna says. And then so Krishna recommends karma yoga. So basically what is happening in the 18th chapter is that the overall flow of the Bhagavad Gita is being taken to its culmination. The culmination of the Gita is surrender to the Lord, and that has been talked about earlier also. The 10th chapter where Krishna says those who know him, surrender, become wholeheartedly devoted to him. That same trajectory which has been covered earlier, Krishna will cover in a summary in this chapter. So first Krishna says, what is better? Renounced action. So do the action. Don't just give up your responsibilities and renounce the world. Rather, do your responsibilities with a renounced disposition. Now, renounced disposition means what? One understands that the ultimate fruit of the work we are doing is not in this world, but it is beyond this world. It is in the raising of our human consciousness. It is in the increased attachment to our Lord. That is what we are seeking ultimately. That's 1 to 12. Then Krishna talks about how when somebody is doing karma yoga, how do they evolve from the level of karma yoga to a higher level? That happens, he says, by the awakening of jnana within them, by the awakening of knowledge. And that knowledge essentially means that they start understanding that actually when I function, I am not the sole doer of things. I am only one of the doers, and there are many other doers also. Many other factors which shape the result of our actions. What does that mean? Krishna talks about, say, for example, if I'm speaking right now. So while speaking, I may think I'm speaking this, I'm giving this talk, which is true, but it's not the complete truth. First of all, my body has to be healthy. And then the specific organ that I'm using for speaking, that is my vocal cords, they need to be functional. Then after that, I, as the conscious being, the soul has to be present. And whatever we do, it is not that the first time we are even necessarily able to do it well. We practice. By the practice, gradually we start improving, and eventually we do things in a good way. So there is endeavor that is required. And ultimately, he says that there are many factors beyond our control. So right now, if the internet breaks down, if the internet goes off, the purpose of delivering this class, which is helping all of you gain a deeper appreciation of the Gita, that purpose will not be fulfilled. So he says that there are multiple factors which shape the result of an action. So the action doesn't, so we are not the sole doers. So karma yoga means acting with the knowledge that we are not the sole doers, and that there are factors beyond us. So if we get attached to the result and we think that the result is what we get in this world from our actions, then if the results don't come, we feel, what is the point of doing any action? But if you understand there are results beyond this world, and if the results in this world come, that's wonderful. But if we act we function with a mood of detachment, then we grow from wherever we are. We internally grow in knowledge, in consciousness, in renunciation, in devotion. And that is the success of Karma Yoga. In Karma Yoga, the idea is that we do karma, and the results of the karma Krishna takes away. Krishna takes away our karma and gives us the yoga. The yoga is connection with Him. And thus we become elevated and liberated. So first Krishna talks about his five factors from 13 to 17. Then 18 to 40, he talks about the jnana of a karma yogi. In another way, that because in this particular section, Krishna has introduced the three modes of material nature in chapter 14. So then he gives various components of action. And he says how all of them can be within the three modes. So for example, when we function in the world, there is jnana. First, we acquire knowledge. So the way we perceive the world can be in the three modes, can be in goodness, passion, ignorance. So say somebody comes into a room, and maybe if they're in goodness, they will look at, is there a library over here? Is there books for reading? What can I learn over here? Somebody's ignorance, they may just first come and look, is there a bed? I just want to go to sleep. Or is there a liquor? Is there a bar with liquor? Is there a cabinet with some drinks in it? I want to take some beer. Or somebody in passion may look, what is the financial level of this people living in this room, people owning this room? They may look at that way. So the way we acquire knowledge depends, it's also shaped by the three modes of material nature. So basically, Krishna is saying that in order to act with detachment, you need to spiritualize all, at least come to goodness, bring to goodness, or raise to transcendence all the components of action. So here it talks about goodness. So when we acquire knowledge and goodness, we see that there is oneness underlying all the diversities. That is first he talks about knowledge. Then after that, when we perceive, then we have to act. So what is the way in which we act? That is karta. And then what kind of actions that we do? That is karma. And then while doing actions, we have certain intelligence and certain determination. So Krishna talks, differentiates here between knowledge and intelligence. In English, there are many different words. You know, we have wisdom. Or in our tradition, we have what is called realization. So there is information and wisdom. Or knowledge and wisdom. So basically, Krishna differentiates knowledge and intelligence over here, jnana and buddhi. And jnana is about how we perceive the world, what we take in from the world. And buddhi is about how we act in the world. So those with buddhi, Krishna talks about how those with buddhi in goodness can act in a more elevated way. they understand this is healthy, this is unhealthy. And those in ignorance pursue the opposite. They pursue the unhealthy as healthy and healthy as unhealthy. And thus they become self-destructive. And then determination means that we all hold on to something or the other. Sometimes suppose we are addicted to something, we may say, I just can't give this up. I have no determination. But actually, addiction itself is a form of determination. Because we are holding on to that particular thing, no matter what the price of it. So holding on to something itself is determination. But when we hold on to something good, that is healthy. That is what it's called, usually we call as determination. When we hold on to something which is bad, we call it as stubbornness, pig-headedness, obstinacy. And that same holding on to something unwanted in terms of a behavior or substance, that is called as addiction. So everybody has determination. Even addicts who keep relapsing into some kind of behavior, they have determination. It's just that their determination is misdirected. So if we can direct our determination properly, then we all can become elevated. And then lastly, Krishna talks about happiness in the three modes. When he talks about happiness in the three modes, he says that there is something which just gives us a notion of pleasure, but it is from beginning to end, it is simply misery. That is an ignorance. And that which tastes like nectar in the beginning, but like poison in the end, that is impassion. And that which is like poison in the beginning, but like nectar in the end, that is ingoodness. And in this way, Krishna gives various levels of pleasure. And he says, so overall, the purpose of this analysis is to get us to be situated in goodness and thus work with detachment. And then Krishna brings us together with Varnashram in the next 41 to 48. So this we discuss 18 to 40. In 41 to 48, he focuses on the qualities of people in the three modes of material, in the various Varanas. The idea is that everybody, whatever be their position, they all can become elevated. One of the most common criticisms of India and Indian culture in the West is the caste system. It is so terribly discriminatory. It is true, historically the caste system was discriminatory, but originally the purpose was not called caste system, it was Varnashram. And the purpose was not discrimination, but division of labor. So that everybody could be engaged in a way that is compatible with their nature. And Krishna says that sve sve karmanya bhirata samsiddhim labhate naraha, that everybody by doing their work can become elevated. So even those who are considered low castes, if they do their work responsibly, even they can become elevated. So it is not that only people who are in the higher castes can become elevated. And in the context of the Bhagavad-gita, Krishna is telling Arjuna, you are a Kshatriya, you work as a Kshatriya. You don't have to become a Brahmana in order to be elevated. As a Kshatriya also, you can rise. And then after that, he says, we can all work according to our nature and gradually become elevated. And then he talks of 49 to 55. But Arjuna asks, does one never have to renounce the world at all? He said, yes, we can renounce, but only when one has become sufficiently mature enough to live a life of renunciation. So Jnana Yoga is the path of renunciation, where there is Jnana itself in knowledge. Jnana Yoga is different from Jnana. Jnana Yoga is basically focused more on Jnana Yoga is where their primary process of spiritual connection is through an intellectual analysis. So that is different. Yes. So Jnana Yoga with Bhakti is offered to Krishna. So Krishna, as I said, this whole chapter is progressing so that everybody can rise to the ultimate perfection of life. And thus, he focuses here on this principle that one can become elevated through spiritual practices. So through Jnana Yoga, from Karma Yoga, one develops detachment. In Jnana Yoga, one renounces the world. But in Krishna says that Jnana Yoga itself is not the perfection. Through intellectual analysis, one has to attain devotion and attain devotional absorption. So it is not just like a rejection of the world, but connection with the ultimate reality that is important. That is 49 to 55. And 56 to 78 is again Bhakti Yoga, in which it's one of the most moving sections. Krishna first says that, so Krishna has given this gradual progression. Okay, first you do Karma Yoga, then you do Jnana Yoga, then you will come to Bhakti Yoga. And then you'll attain life's perfection. But then Krishna says that actually Bhakti Yoga is such a thing, even if you are at the level of Karma Yoga or even below the level of Karma Yoga, from there itself you can start bhakti. So bhakti is at the summit of the yoga ladder, but bhakti is also like a ladder that goes down, 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 and can elevate people from the lowest level to the highest. So sarva karmaanya pisada kurvaanu madvipashraya mat prasada davapnoti shashvatam padmavayam. So Krishna says that if you just, whatever work you are doing, if you do it diligently, then you, in a mood of devotion, then you can attain me. And here, Krishna very strongly stresses that, yes, you have particular modes and your body will function according to those modes. This body is a machine. And you cannot reject the way the machine functions. Say, for example, if somebody is riding a bicycle, somebody is driving a car, somebody is driving a plane, somebody is driving a boat, then each particular machine will function a particular way. And we cannot get a bike to function like a boat. We cannot get a plane to function like a bicycle. So each machine will have its own particular way of functioning. Krishna says that we can't control that. That's how it will function. But whatever be the machine you have, you can decide, you cannot change the nature of the machine, but you can change the direction in which the machine is going. We cannot jump out of one vehicle and go into another vehicle. If we have a bike, we cannot suddenly change. That means that's the particular kind of body we have. We can't change it and make it into a plane. But even on a bike, we can change which direction the bike is going. So Krishna says, here is the body. The soul is here. The body machine is there. And beyond that, the Supreme is there. So if we surrender to the Supreme, we make him our destination, then whatever be the kind of bodily machine we have and whatever be the kind of activities that we are doing in harmony with that bodily machine, we can attain life's ultimate perfection. This is how 1862 Krishna says, Tameva sharanam gacha sarvabhavena bharata tat prasadat param shantim sthanam prapsasi shashvatam. So tam eva sharanam gacha, surrender unto him, and thus you can all attain perfection. At this point in 1863, Krishna concludes and he says, in this way, Arjuna, I have spoken what I need to speak. And now you deliberate and you do as you desire. This is a very significant verse, where this 1863, do as you desire. What it means is, that Krishna is here revealing that he is a God who respects human intelligence and respects human independence. You have free will, you do as you desire. But don't just do as you desire, deliberate and do as you desire. So the Bhagavad Gita appeals to human intelligence and acknowledges human independence. One of my friends wanted to write a book on the 10 commandments from the Bhagavad Gita. So I told him, please don't write a book like this, because the Bhagavad Gita's mood is not of commandments. It is of choices and consequences. You do this, this will happen. If you do this, this will happen. Now you deliberate, you contemplate, and then make your choice. So, and in this, from here onwards, our acharyas give, especially Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur, who is a very prominent commentator in our tradition. He gives a beautiful commentary in this section. So at this point, when Krishna tells Arjuna that now you deliberate and decide, it's like a very serious class is going on. And at that time, suddenly the speaker says, okay, now what do you want to do? The audience has to process, oh really, we are meant to do something. The audience has to process everything that they have heard, and then they have to shape, they have to decide what are we meant to do. So at that time, Arjuna becomes lost in thought. He becomes pensive. Oh, what am I to do? And seeing Arjuna lost deep in thought, thinking, oh, Krishna spoke this in the second chapter, spoke that in the fourth chapter, spoke that in the 10th chapter, spoke that in the 15th chapter. What am I to do? And seeing Krishna, he sees that Arjuna is lost in thought like this. Krishna's heart overflows with compassion. And Krishna says, oh, Arjuna, I will tell you the most confidential knowledge, because you are most dear to me. You are most dear to me. It says that I am determined to love you. Ishto sime drudhamiti. Earlier, several times Krishna has said that drudha, we have to be determined to serve Krishna. We have to be determined to grow spiritually. But here Krishna uses the same word drudha to describe his relationship with us, his compassion for us. And he says, I am determined to love you. And because I'm determined to do good for you, that's why I'm telling you the most confidential knowledge. And then Krishna repeats in 1865, more or less the same verse he has spoken in 934. Manmana bhav madbhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishyasi satyam te pratijane priyosi me. So earlier he has said there's more of the same things. You think of me, you become my devotee, offer your obeisances to me, worship me, and like this you will come to me. But earlier in 934 he said that if you do this and in this way you devote your life to me, then you will come to me. But in 1865 he says, if you do this, then I guarantee you, you will surely come to me. So what is happening? That what is stressed is very important. Sometimes the same point, it can have a very different meaning if the stress is different. Say for example, if you want to recommend someone for a particular responsibility, service, post, we may say that he had problems earlier, but he's stable now. But if you want to deride or minimize someone and not recommend them, we could take the same facts and say he's stable now, but he had problems earlier. So what is emphasized here is that what comes in the second half of the sentence. So here similarly, what is happening? Krishna initially is saying that you do all this, and in this way, if you devote yourself to me, you'll come to me. But here he's saying, if you do this, I guarantee you will come to me. It's like somebody wants to sell a house. They want to do a deal, and they say, you do this, then I'll hand over the land deal to you, the papers to you. But then if they become desperate, they just want to sell the house, they want to make a deal, then they may say that, we just do this, I guarantee you this property will be yours. All the documents will be transferred to you. So Krishna is, his compassion is overflowing in his heart. And then so 1865 and 1866 are considered to be the crown verses of the Bhagavad Gita. 1866 is that famous verse. Just give up everything else and surrender to me. Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. Aham tvam sarva papebhyo mokshayishyami ma shuchaha. So the beautiful verse which Krishna says that, actually, don't get caught in religious technicalities or formularies. Understand that you have to surrender to me. So this is an amazingly non-sectarian verse. That religion is meant for God. God is not meant for religion. Krishna says, you give up religion if you have to come to God. If that's what is required to come up to God. So it's not that you give up religion, become irreligious. But if any religious ritual, any religious formula, any religious dogma, if it doesn't help you to come to God, then put that aside. And just focus on devotional surrender to the divine. And if the world criticizes you because you gave up apparently some rituals or dogmas, Krishna says, I will protect you from all reactions. This is like a concluding call for love. Call of love. And then Krishna says, there's a Phala Shruti. he says that if you share this message with the world, then you will become extremely dear to me and you will become liberated. So generally, in any sacred book, in most sacred books in the Bhakti tradition or in the broad dharmic tradition, there is what is called Phalashruti. Phalashruti is the fruit of hearing this. So Krishna gives the fruit of hearing at three levels. He says, if after hearing this message, you share it with others, then you will be profoundly enriched. You will become very dear to me and you will attain me. And somebody may say, oh, but actually, you know, sharing this message with others is very difficult. I can't do it. Okay. So it's like somebody has fallen in a well and they can't get out. And somebody throws a rope from outside. They say, just hold on to this rope and I'll pull you out. But suppose the person says, oh, actually, holding on to the rope, you know, it will cause me so much pain on my arms when my whole weight will fall on the ropes. Then, okay. And that person may say, okay, I'll make a knot around at the bottom of the rope. I'll throw it down to you. And you just put that lasso kind of thing around your waist and I will pull you out. So you don't have to hold the weight. So like that, Krishna gives one more level. He says, if you can't share this message with others, just study this message. Even by that, you will become, by such study, you'll be worshipping me with your intelligence and you'll attain me ultimately. So the study of the sacred message of the Gita is not just an intellectual activity, it is a devotional activity. And now somebody can say, no, but actually if I tie the rope around my waist, then it will cause me so much pain in my waist, or it will squeeze my waist. Then the person from above says that, okay, you know, I will tie this rope to a bucket, a big, large bucket, and send that down to you. I'll send a tub down to you, tie it to a tub, and you sit in that tub, and you just sit there, I'll pull you out. So Krishna then says that, if you can't study this message, just hear it. And if you hear it, then also you'll become elevated. And in that way, Krishna is making himself and his grace more and more accessible to everyone. And in the last words Krishna speaks is that, Arjuna, has your doubt been dispelled? Have you become clear about what you are meant to do? Nashto moha smriti labdhata prasadanmaya chuta sitosmi gata sandeha karishye vachanam tava. Sorry, that is the next verse. Is what Arjuna's response is. Arjuna says, yes, I have become freed from all doubt and now I have become situated in determination. So it's significant that at the end of the Bhagavad-gītā, Arjuna doesn't say, I will fight. He says, I will do your will. The Bhagavad-gītā is not a call for violence. It is a call neither for violence nor for silence. It is a call for transcendence. And transcendence means go beyond worldly considerations of profit and loss, of victory and defeat, of violence or silence, and focus on transcendence. What is the best way to connect with the divine? What is the best way to serve the divine? And act accordingly. So that is the mood of surrender of Krishna, of Arjuna. Karishye vachanam tava. I will do your will. And that is, at one level, the end of the Bhagavad Gita. But there are five more verses from 74 to 78. Which are spoken by Sanjay. The Bhagavad Gita is like a nested conversation. It's first between Krishna and Arjuna, but it's also between Sanjay is telling the same message to Dhritarashtra. And Krishna's message to Arjuna transforms Arjuna's heart. And his confusion goes away, his attachments disappear, and he becomes situated in divine determination. Unfortunately, when Sanjay speaks the same message to Dhritarashtra, Dhritarashtra's heart is not transformed. But through Sanjay's example, Krishna demonstrates the teaching that work with detachment. That working with detachment can lead to spiritual attachment. That is demonstrated in the conclusion of the Gita. How? That Sanjay, he speaks the same message and what happens to him? He becomes enriched with absorption in Krishna's message and Krishna's form. He says in 76 and 77 that Rishyami cha mohur moho. I'm thrilled at every moment. So if we work with a devotional purposefulness, sometimes the result will manifest in the world, sometimes the results may not manifest in the world. However, we will always be elevated and liberated because our consciousness will rise upward. And the Sanjay's example shows that this is what happens, that he becomes absorbed in Krishna and he becomes thrilled. And the last verse of the Bhagavad Gita is a prophecy of spiritual victory. He says that wherever there is Krishna and where there is Arjuna, there will be victory. That's what the conclusion is. Now, Arjuna at the start of the Gita had put aside his bow, saying, I can't fight, I've lost heart. That was 146. He puts aside his bow. But the last verse, 1878, is describing Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna, Yatra Partho Dhanurdhara. That Arjuna has picked up his bow in readiness to fight. So the Bhagavad Gita is a historical historical account, but it's also a trans-historical account. And in the trans-historical understanding, we could say that Arjuna's bow represents our enthusiasm, our determination. When we are faced with life's perplexities and complexities, we might lose heart and we might put aside his bow, our bow. We may lose our determination. I just can't do this. But if we hear the Bhagavad Gita's message, our consciousness rises upward toward Krishna, and we see our life's purpose as not just resolving all the endless complexities of life, but we see our life's purpose as developing an endless connection with the divine. Then again, our morale will be restored. If you understand that no matter how dark life goes, turns to be around us, God is present within our hearts. Krishna is there and he can light and lighten our heart. He can illumine as well as unburden our heart. He can light and lighten our heart. Then turning toward Krishna can empower us in all situations. And that is the concluding call of devotional inspiration with which the Bhagavad Gita ends. So this last, so to summarize, in these last three chapters that we discussed, Krishna talks about the divine and demonic natures in the 16th chapter, where he describes how we are born with certain dispositions, with certain qualities, and certain activities grow accordingly. But if we regulate our activities according to scripture, then from wherever we are, we can become elevated. And 17th chapter talks about those who don't follow scripture, but they have some faith and they follow something according to some non-scriptural ideas. And to understand where they are at, Krishna talks about the three modes and look at the way they live. Don't just try to identify their philosophy, but rather try to understand the way they live. And in that he talks about the food they eat as well as the austerity, charity and sacrifice that they do. And ultimately, whatever we are doing, it is done to invoke the ultimate reality, then that is auspicious. In 18th chapter, Krishna talks about multiple, summarizes and brings together in a synergistic whole all that he has spoken earlier. He talks about karma yoga. Then he talks about how jnana arises from karma yoga by talking about the various five factors of action and the components of action within the three modes. Then he talks about the structure for spiritual evolution. First, karma yoga within varnashram, then renouncing, and then connecting with the divine. And how the process of connecting with the divine through bhakti can elevate us from wherever we are to life's highest perfection. And that progressive elevation is also demonstrated at the end through Sanjay. And although his speaking, the message doesn't transform Dhritarashtra's heart, but it transforms his own heart, making him enlivened and absorbed in Krishna. So thank you very much for your attention and participation. And if any of you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I have unmuted you. Oh. I have given you the facility to unmute yourself. You can ask questions if any of you have any. Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, I have one question. You talked about ideological versus functional faith. So yeah. Could you please elaborate over that a little bit more? Because what leads to a difference between ideological and functional faith? Because sometimes when we have faith in ideology, we usually function over that ideology. So, but what leads to a difference between the two?
Good question. Okay. So what causes a difference between ideological faith and functional faith? People adopt their various ideologies based on various factors. Some ideologies are consciously adopted using calm, considered deliberation, and some ideologies are just maybe subconsciously through osmosis taken in by just by the social influence around us. So for example, some people grow up in a particular culture where a particular society, particular family, particular dynasty, where a particular kind of worship is being done, a particular kind of belief system is held. And they may just adopt that belief system and move on during their lives without considering anything else. Sometimes some people may adopt some ideology because because it's fashionable, in the sense that it gives them a lot of prestige in that society. So some people might memorize Bhagavad-gītā verses and quote them because they might get a lot of prestige in a particular social circle. But whether they believe in the Gita, they want to mold their life according to the Gita, that might be very different. It's like there are professional speakers whose primary purpose is to earn money, not to share the message of God. There are even academic scholars on religion who study religion more as a social phenomena than rather as a spiritual process. And then they may also not, their knowledge, they may have a particular ideology, but that might not transform into a way they live. Another could be that just people have their conditionings. That means somebody might be from the past, they have a strong influence of the mode of ignorance within them. Then that influence of ignorance may not go away immediately. So for example, somebody might be very short-tempered and they come to Krishna and they understand about how lust, anger, greed are, say, undesirable and they need to be overcome. But while they are practicing, while serving Krishna, if anybody crosses them, even other devotees cross them, they might become very angry. Now, depending on how deep-rooted the conditioning of anger is, for some people, they practice bhakti a little bit and their anger goes away. For some others, their anger may not go away because it's a very deep-rooted conditioning. And for some people, it might be that they have a conditioning to be angry, but then they might think that my anger is righteous. You know, you are not doing the right thing and therefore I have a right to be angry with you. Such people often become self-righteous. So we have to be be both cautious and considerate. Cautious means when we are practicing when we are doing our particular practices, we are adopting a particular ideology. Let it be clear, what is the purpose of this? I'm learning all this to raise my consciousness, to make my consciousness more attached to the divine. Simultaneously, we also have to consider that when others are doing it, they may be coming from different backgrounds and what is easy for me may not be that easy for them. So I should be considerate. So we have to see why that gap is happening. And for sometimes the gap might get close quickly, but sometimes the gap may take more time to close. So there is, for all of us, there is a distance between what we profess and what we practice. But is that gap decreasing or is it increasing? And what is our attitude toward that gap? Is it that we are at least striving to decrease it, or we are just trying to cover up the gap? Or is it that we are actually expanding the gap? So if we see this way, then we can work accordingly. Does it answer your question?
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Hi, Krishna Prabhu. I wonder if you could go back to that verse where Krishna, 1866, I think, where he asks us to give up all volition and just surrender unto him. The reason why I'm asking is because, as you said, you know, religion is meant to bring us to God. So, you know, I know I'm thinking this is a common question. You know, how is it that that which is supposed to take us toward God, God is asking us to give up, to give it up? So in that verse, what does he really mean by religion?
Okay. Thank you. Good question. That I can answer this at. So what does Krishna mean when he says sarva dharma antartya, give up dharma? What does religion mean over there? Okay, there is a contextual meaning over there and there is a universal meaning over there. So contextually, Arjuna at the start of the Gita was torn between two dharmas. Their dharma means duty or even religious duty. One duty was that he had a kshatriya duty. He was a warrior, and as a martial guardian of society, anybody who is an aggressor, he has to fight against them and curb them. So that was his one duty, kshatriya duty. The other was that he was a member of a particular family, a particular dynasty. That was his kula. Kula is a Sanskrit word for dynasty. So he had a kula dharma. That is his dynastic duty. And that was that he has to, because he belongs to a family, he has to protect the members of the family. And he has to, but now what does he do if the aggressors are the members of his family? So Arjuna was torn between Kshatriya dharma required him to fight, Kula dharma required him to not fight. So what should he do at that time? So Krishna tells Arjuna that there are various levels of dharma, and don't get caught so much in Kshatriya dharma or Kula dharma. Understand the purpose of all dharma is to come closer to me, to ultimately attain me. So give up all those dharmas, all the duties that obstruct you from coming to me, just give them aside, put them aside. That doesn't mean that Arjuna became adharmic. It just meant that Arjuna did not get caught in technicalities. He focused on the ultimate purpose. Now, Arjuna did fight, but as I said, Arjuna did not fight thinking I am a Kshatriya and I have to fight. Arjuna fought thinking that this is what my Lord wants me to do. Karishye vachinam tavo, I will do your will. So, is Krishna telling us to give up dharma per se? No. In our case, we all have different obligations. Even devotionally also, there can be different obligations. So what do we do when we are pulled in different directions? So sometimes there are different religious rituals. You know, should I do this or should I do that? Should I... We can get torn between different duties. At that time, we, instead of getting caught in the technicality, we focus on the ultimate purpose and make the right choice. So Krishna is telling, so can religion obstruct us from going to God? But it's not religion per se. Within religion, we might have different duties to do. So for example, when Prabhupada was in India, at that time, there was an idea based on certain dharmic texts that sannyasi should not travel across the ocean because the lands across the ocean were considered to be impure and sannyasis may get contaminated by going there. Therefore, they should not travel. But Prabhupada put that aside because he considered that my spiritual master has told me to travel, and ultimately the Lord's purpose is that we all become elevated and that his message be available to everyone far and wide. So he traveled. That way, the idea is that each one of us has to avoid getting caught in technicalities and focus on the ultimate purpose. So you could say here, we often say that there's the letter of the law and there's the spirit of the law. So what Krishna is saying in Sarva Dharman Pratyajam Amekam Charanam Vraja is that don't get caught in the letter of the law. Letter of the law is the various dharmas. The spirit of the law is Mamekam Sharanam Vraja. The surrender to me. Does it answer your question?
Yes, Prabhu. Yeah, it seems you're saying that there's like different gradations of duty, and we have to see how whatever duties we're torn by, how it serves the ultimate duty, right?
Yeah, it's perfect.
Okay. I mean, I have another question, but I know I want to see if anybody else also has another question, if there's time.
I don't see any other hands right now. You can ask.
Okay, then I will ask about the very last verse. If you could elaborate on what is meant by wherever there is Arjuna and wherever there is Krishna, there is victory. So when that verse says wherever there is Arjuna, I know you talked about the bow and determination. Is that what is meant by wherever there is Arjuna? And also wherever there is Krishna, if you could elaborate on what that means too. So
when Krishna says, in the last verse of the Gita says, wherever there is Krishna and wherever there is Arjuna, there is victory. What does that mean? What does the wherever mean? Again, there is a contextual meaning and there is a transcontextual meaning. So contextually, the Bhagavad Gita begins with a question by Dhritarashtra to Sanjay, what happened on the Kurukshetra battlefield? That. Now, say suppose a sports match is going on somewhere and you want to know what happened. So we want to know the specifics, but essentially what we want to know is who's winning, who's going to win. So similarly, the Dhritarashtra's essential question was, who's going to win? Who's going to win? And now Sanjay did not want to directly say that your party is going to lose, because Sanjay was an employee of the Dhritarashtra, and Sanjay also had an affectionate relationship with the Dhritarashtra, respectful, affectionate relationship. So he didn't want to be blunt. In English, there are euphemisms. We soften harsh truths. So similarly, what he does, he doesn't say that your sons will lose, and he doesn't say that the opponents of your sons are going to win. He just makes a statement that side where Krishna and Arjuna are there will be victory over there. So it is clear, but it is not that direct. So, and he is giving, so that is the contextual meaning, that it is your sons are not going to be successful, the Kauravas are not going to be successful, the Pandavas are going to be successful. Beyond that, he's also giving a universal meaning that Krishna is of course God, and Arjuna represents every man. Arjuna represents all of us. So wherever Krishna and Arjuna are together, united in purpose, there'll be victory. Now God is of course, now sometimes we all face impossible odds. And when we face impossible odds, we might become disheartened and not even try, thinking this is never going to work. But at such times, if you understand that actually Krishna, that God can make even the impossible possible. So Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna. Yogeshwara refers to the Lord of all mystic power. That means that which is not possible for us to do, God can do it. But what is required from us? Yatra Partho Dhanurdhira. And just as Arjuna had picked up his bow in readiness to fight, similarly, we also have to pick up our bow in readiness to fight. And if we do that, so if we are determined to serve, then Krishna will empower in extraordinary ways. Now, how exactly he will empower, how exactly results will come about, we can't be sure. And when it will happen, that also we can't be sure. So we could say that the same verse 1878 is demonstrated in Srila Prabhupada's life. Prabhupada was like Partha Dhanurdhara. Prabhupada was determined to glorify Krishna. to share Krishna's glories far and wide with people. And although he had no resources, he was old and he didn't have any money, he didn't have any followers. He came to America and it was almost mission impossible. And in fact, in the song that Prabhupada writes, it's a prayer which Prabhupada composes on reaching the American coastland. He's offering his prayer to Krishna. And he says there also he uses the word word synonymous to Yogeshwar in his prayer. He says, Krishna, you are the Lord of all mystic power and you can make anything happen. So what that means, if a devotee is determined to serve the Lord, then even if the odds are impossible, then the Lord can make the impossible possible and victory will come upon that devotee. So that is the trans-concept, contextual, universal meaning of that verse. Does that answer your question?
Yes, but this word victory, when we exercise our determination, isn't it that it doesn't necessarily mean that the outcome that we're striving for will be the result? You know, isn't the victory, doesn't that word have a broader meaning? Because, you know, yeah.
Okay. Doesn't victory have a broader meaning? Well, again, you will have to see the contextual and transcontextual. Contextually, it is a prediction of what is going, it is a prophecy of what is going to happen on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, that Krishna and Arjuna, their side, the Pandavas, are going to be victorious. Now, in our case, when we talk about when we are trying to serve the Lord, what does victory mean?
Now, if you
look at Srila Prabhupada's example again, now, is it that every single thing that Prabhupada tried was successful? Not necessarily. That, say, for example, he tried to make the League of Devotees in India. That didn't work. Srila Prabhupada wanted to translate the Bhagavatam, and he was not able to complete the whole Bhagavatam. He completed up to 10th canto, and that he considered to be his life's magnum opus. And yet, that was not completed. Now, was that but many other things that Prabhupada did, they worked out spectacularly successful. He was able to open a temple in Vrindavan. He was able to open temples in America, so many places. So it's not necessary that every single thing that a devotee does will be successful. What it means that overall, a devotee's purpose will be successful. And the purpose is basically, when we practice devotion, there are broadly two purposes. There is connection with Krishna and there is contribution for Krishna. Connection with Krishna is when we try to serve Krishna determinedly, it is we become more and more connected with him just by the attempt to serve him. And contribution for Krishna is that what we want to do, we are able to do something for Krishna. So victory has both aspects, connection and contribution. Now, sometimes some devotees, they may preach lifelong, but they may never become very famous or very celebrated or very hugely successful in terms of their contribution manifesting in the world's eyes. But they might be unknown, unsung devotees, but they may be very deeply connected with Krishna. And that is a victory. For some people, they are themselves connected with Krishna and they also make a lot of contribution in the outer world. So the victory has both meanings, connection and contribution in the trans-contextual, universal sense. For some people, the connection will be deeper. For some people, contribution will be greater. We'll have to see what will be apply for whom. But the idea is what Krishna has said earlier in 640, that one who does good will never be lost. That nahi kalyana krut kaschit durgatim tat gacchati. That same point is there, that whoever strives to work with determination and is accompanied by the mystical Lord, their efforts will not be in vain. They'll be victorious. Now, what exact form the victory will take? We are not omnipotent. So it is not that every single thing that we do will become successful. No matter how devoted we are to the Lord, that doesn't mean everything we do will become successful. But our overall purpose will be successful. In that sense, we'll be victorious. Does that answer your question?
Very nicely. Thank you so much for the meditation.
So thank you very much for your attention and participation. So we come to the end of our journey in Gita Light. And I look forward to your feedback, both constructive, positive, negative, whatever it is that can help me to serve better. And I would like to especially thank Gaur Kumar Prabhu for taking the initiative in organizing this course, as well as working out all the logistics so that we could make it happen. And I hope and pray that all of you, whatever understanding you have got of the Bhagavad Gita through this, it can increase your taste for the Gita and your taste for Krishna. So all the very best. Thank you. Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki
jai. Hare Krishna Prabhu, thank you.
Hare Krishna, thank you so very much, Prabhu, for your time and everything that you shared with us. Thank you for your service. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, thank you so much.
Thank you. Happy to your service. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Take care. Cool.